Welcome to Christ Virtual Church, and welcome to a brand new year. I can't believe it. We've made it through 2020, and now you and I stand together in the doorway to a brand new year, 2021. Hey, and if you're watching me right now on Facebook, why don't you let me know that you're out there? Give me a like or give me a heart or give me a comment. And go ahead and share this also with everybody, because we want to keep this good news of Jesus getting around to everyone that we know. And you know, I want to wish all of you a happy new year, because here's what I'm thinking. We're going to have some fun in 21. And here's a New Year's resolution for you. Why don't you say this? I resolve to make every day a New Year's day. Because listen, think about it with me. Every day is a new day of new blessings, of new beginnings, of new opportunities to love life and love God and love the people that you're close to. Here's our band right now, recorded live in worship with New Year's Day.
I buy a lot of diaries, fill them full of good intentions. Each and every New Year's Eve, I make myself a list. All the things I'm gonna change until January 2nd. So this time I'm making one more list. It's doable, 'cause I believe in second chances, just the way that I believe in you. Yeah, this will be my resolution. Every day is New Year's Day. Oh, this could start a revolution. Every day is one more chance to start all over. One more chance to change and grow, and one more chance to grab a hold of grace and never let it go.
Should old acquaintance be forgot and days of old anxiety?
This will be my resolution. Every day is New Year's Day. Oh, this could start a revolution. Every day is, every day is. This will be my resolution. Every day is New Year's Day. Oh, this could start a revolution. Every day is, every day is. This will be my resolution. Every day is New Year's Day. Oh, this could start a revolution.
feel it in your heart, people of God. Feel it in your heart. Go ahead and get emotional right now. Happy Sunday. Well, you know, it's all right to be honest about your emotions. Jesus was an emotional person. He was a deeply feeling young man. He felt love. He felt sorrow. He felt anger. He felt joy. In fact, if you read through all four Gospels, you see that he actually displays 39 different emotions in the course of those Gospels. 39. Now, to tell you the truth, I didn't even know there were 39 different emotions. That is until I raised teenagers. When you raise teenagers, you can discover that they can go through all 39 different emotions in one 30-second conversation. And what I want to do today with you is this. I want to look at the most powerful emotion that Jesus ever experienced. And this is the emotion he feels toward you. You bring up some feelings in Jesus. Did you know that? You bring up very, very strong feelings in Jesus. Jesus honestly gets emotional when he thinks about you. And today I want to show you the intensity of that emotion. So I'm going to take you right now to a little stone village. A little stone village that sits on the side of a mountain. It's the village of Nain. Here's what happened one day in the little village of Nain. Jesus went with his disciples to the village of Nain, and a large crowd followed him. A funeral procession was coming out as he approached the village gate. The young man who had died was a widow's only son, and a large crowd from the village was with her. When the Lord saw her, his heart overflowed with compassion. "Don't cry," he said. Then he stopped, and then he walked over to the coffin and touched it, and the bearers stopped. "Young man," he said, "I tell you, get up." Then the dead boy sat up and began to talk, and Jesus gave him back to his mother. Great fear swept over the crowd, and they began praising God, saying, "A mighty prophet has risen among us, and God has visited his people today." So let's try to visualize this together. This would have been a funeral procession that was very different than the funeral processions that we have today. You know, with a big black hearse and a long line of cars with their lights on. No, this would be a very different scene, a very loud scene, a very emotional scene. There would have been a crowd of people walking down the middle of the street, filling up the whole street, carrying an exposed dead body in an open coffin. And some of them are playing flutes, and some of them are shaking tambourines, and all of them are wailing and shouting and just crying out their words of grief. You see, this is not a culture where you stay stoic, where you're expected to remain calm and cool and collected at all times. This is a culture where you're supposed to let it all out. You display on the outside whatever you're feeling on the inside. And so if you love someone, if you really love and respect someone, you better let the world know it by letting them hear and see all that grief pouring out of you. And so they're wailing with sadness, and the cries are echoing off the stone buildings down the narrow cobblestone street. And now there's a lot of things we don't know about that day. We don't know how old this woman was. She could have been 20 years old. She could have been 30. We don't know how her husband died. Could have been an accident. Could have been an illness. We don't know how old her boy was. He could have been 12 years old. He could have been as old as 20. We just don't know how old he was or how he died. What we do know is that the boy died the day before. And the reason we know that is because back then, they didn't have formaldehyde or embalming chemicals. And so in that very hot climate that they lived in, you would have to bury a body very quickly. And so they always did it 24 hours later. They always did it on the next day. So if you can imagine, you've got this mom who's already buried her husband, and now she loses her only child. and she is overwrought with emotion. She is feeling shock right now. She is feeling broken right now. She cannot believe that this has happened to her. And she is overwhelmed with the grief of the whole thing. At her deepest, deepest moment of emotional pain. And the Bible says these words, "The Lord saw her." Now, what's amazing to me is this is a big crowd of people. This is a big commotion. This is a big drama. You would kind of expect that Jesus would be distracted. You would expect that people would be pushing and shoving, and he'd be trying to get out of their way. And these two big crowds of people, the crowd following Jesus and the crowd with this woman as part of the funeral, they'd converge trying to both fit through this narrow gateway of the city gates all at one time. And you would think he would just be concentrating on that. But what the Bible tells us is that he didn't just see, he noticed. You see, there is a difference between looking and seeing. He noticed, right? I mean, like, I'm a guy, and I can look, and I can see something sometimes, and I just don't notice. Like, one time Kathy had her hair done a little bit different, and kind of different highlights. And now, like, I'm sure I saw her, but I didn't notice. And so, here's a marital tip for you guys. Here's what I do now. Every week, you know, 2-3 times a week, I'll say, "Hey, your hair looks great." You know, just playing it safe. Marital tip for you right there. But see, Jesus was different than that. Jesus didn't just look at her, look in her direction. He saw her. He zeroed in on her. In the middle of the crowd, the chaos, the commotion, Jesus focused entirely on that woman. And his heart goes out to her. What emotion did Jesus feel when he saw this poor woman in this kind of deep and profound pain? What Jesus felt for that woman that day is the same thing he feels for you when you're going through something and when you're the one feeling the emotional pain. What he feels for her, he feels for you. When you're afraid, when your marriage is painful, when you're trying to pay the bills and you don't know where you're going to get the money to pay those bills. When you're praying and praying and praying for your child who just seems to be making crazy decisions, and with everything in you, you're aching and you're hoping and you're believing that your child's going to be okay, Jesus feels the same thing for you when you're hurting that he felt for that woman that day when she was hurting. The Bible says that when he saw her, his heart overflowed with compassion. There wasn't enough room, even in the great big heart of Jesus, for all the compassion he felt. He just overflowed with compassion. And the original Greek word that's used right here in this sentence that we translate as compassion is really a powerful word. It's the word in Greek, splagna. Splagna. I like that word a lot. I like that word a lot because I'm a boy and I like gross things. Because the word splagna, it sounds like, well, you ever stuck your finger down your throat and then you just splagna all over the place? I mean, that's pretty much the meaning of this word right here. It's like when you get this overwhelming feeling right down in your guts, right down in your intestines. There is no stronger word in the Greek language to represent the depth of feeling, the depth of compassion. Someone once described it like this. Now, follow me on this. You're going to understand the meaning of this particular word, and the meaning of the way Jesus feels for you. Imagine driving up to a car accident on the road, and you kind of get this sinking feeling. And you're like, oh, boy, I hope nobody's hurt. But as you inch forward in the line of traffic, you see two people lying on the pavement, and the paramedics are working on them. And all of a sudden, you're like, oh, God, I hope that you're going to be able to help those people. I hope those people are going to live. And you're shooting up a prayer to God, and you're really, really feeling for those people going through something that you know is going to be life-changing for them. And then you recognize one of the cars. And you realize that that those people lying there in the street being worked on by the paramedics, those are people you love. Those are people you love. And at that moment, what do? You open up your car door and you swing it open wide and you go running out of your car, just leaving it running right there in the road. And you push past the police officers and you push past the paramedics and you go there to those people lying on the ground. And now what you're feeling at that moment, that is the feeling of splagna. It's just you're sick to your stomach. Your heart is pounding. Your gut is wrenching. And it's coming from the deepest, deepest part of you. That's what Jesus is feeling when he sees that woman in pain. And I want you to know today, that's what Jesus is feeling when you're going through your moment of pain. I don't know who needs to hear that particular word this morning, but I need you to know the Lord of love. The Lord of love knows exactly what you're going through today. And he cares about you more than you can imagine. He knows your pain. He hears the cry of your heart. And when you feel the kind of anxiety where you can barely catch your breath, you're having like a panic attack, or when you're praying for your marriage because it's a marriage that hurts, and when you don't know where your next job is coming from, or when the doctor says it doesn't sound too good for you, he sees, he cares, he notices. And on this day, when Jesus sees this grieving single mom, he steps in front of her and the funeral procession comes to a halt. He says to her, looking her straight in the eyes, gently, tenderly, "Don't cry." He says to her, "Don't cry." And then he takes a step closer to the coffin. And he stretches out his hand and he touches it. He touches the coffin. And what's really interesting is that coffin would not be like anything that you may be picturing in your mind right now. It's not a beautiful polished wooden box with a lid on it. It's more like a plain wooden stretcher with a corpse stretched out on it, completely exposed. So Jesus goes up and he touches the coffin with his hand, and that would be completely shocking, even repulsive to them that day. That's scandalous. And people would gasp as he did that because it was against all of their religious laws and all of their cultural training to touch a dead body or anything associated with it. So Jesus, think of this. Jesus, the perfect, pure, holy incarnate Son of the living God would now be viewed by those people in that crowd as spiritually contaminated, unclean, untouchable. You see, what Jesus did when he touched that coffin is this. He crossed a line. He crossed a line that day. And I love this about Jesus. Jesus is a line crosser. Jesus is a rule breaker. Every time religion would draw a line, Jesus would cross that line. Why? Because love crosses lines. Whatever line you feel right now, maybe keeping God at a distance from you, keeping God far away from you, you need to understand that Jesus crosses those lines for those he loves. Maybe you always thought church wasn't for people like you. Maybe you always thought God would never answer the prayer of somebody like you. Maybe you thought God would never approve of your lifestyle, your personal issues, your coloring outside of the lines in your life. Well, Jesus will cross that line to come to you. And so on that day, in that little stone village on the side of a mountain, Jesus crosses the line, touches the coffin, and the entire crowd gasps. But more importantly, more incredibly, the dead boy gasps. He takes a breath and he sits up and he starts talking. He says, "Mom, what's happening? Where am I? Why are all these people looking at me?" And somebody ought to give God some praise right now, listening to this fact. Because whatever feels dead in your life right now, with one touch, Jesus can bring it back to life. Somebody here, that's what you need. You need one touch, just one touch. One touch from the author of life, the Lord of life, the giver of life, the creator of life, the resurrection and the life, the one who brings dead things back to life. Just one touch, one moment, one word. Just one sense of awareness that not only is he with you right now, but he cares about you. What did it take to completely alter the life of this boy and his grieving mom? Just one touch. My prayer today is that somebody right now listening to this talk, somebody who maybe is listening for the first time, somebody online or on the radio, my prayer is that someone would have that one moment. They'd hear that one word. Maybe one song, one prayer, one sense of the goodness and the grace of God would cut through and cross over whatever barrier you feel has separated you from God. My prayer today is that for somebody who feels anxious and afraid, who feels completely worn and worried, that with just one touch, God would give you back your hope. He would give you back your confidence because you would know that with Jesus beside you, with Jesus caring about you, you and Jesus together, you can handle anything. And for someone who's been down and dark and doubting lately, just one touch would send light back into the darkness. And for someone who's struggling with cancer or depression or addiction, one touch from the Lord of life would be the breakthrough that you need. And you're going to experience that today. And for someone who's never felt close to the Lord Jesus, for someone who's always felt like he's for other people, not for you, for someone who's never crossed the line and invited Jesus into their heart, well, let me tell you something. He's going to cross the line himself. He's going to cross the line and come to you. So welcome him. Welcome him today. Don't turn your back. Don't run away. Step forward to meet him and embrace him. You may be asking, where is God when I hurt? The answer is, he has crossed the line right now to stand beside you. He cares about you more than you can ever imagine. And don't doubt this. Don't doubt me when I tell you this. When that widow's only son felt that jolt, that surge of energy, that power flowing through him, the moment of coming back to life, at that moment he realized that just one touch from the Lord of life, could bring anything dead back to life. So get your hopes up, get your hopes up, get your hopes up, people of God. All you need is just one touch. Would you say this prayer with me now? So Father, today we pray in the name of the one who is the resurrection and the life, that you would touch those who are hurting, those who are lost, those who are afraid, and all of you who are joining us this week on Facebook, online, on the radio, wherever you are hearing these words, if you would just say, yeah, I really want to experience his compassion. I want to know that he cares. I want just one touch. Father, reach out to them right now. Stretch out your hand of blessing. And for those who feel like you've been distant, God, I pray that you would crack open heaven and send one beam of light, one word, one song, one moment. And God, I pray that we would recognize it and believe it and take it to the bank, that you noticed, God. You noticed and you saw our pain and you care from the deepest depths of compassion. And Father, help us as your church to show your compassion, to be rule breakers, line crossers, not drawing lines to keep people out, but crossing lines to bring people in, doing whatever it takes to reach people and love them in your name. I pray this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. And we continue by praying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. In a moment, we'll celebrate the Lord's Supper together. You might want to pause this in just a moment and prepare to join us by getting bread or crackers, juice or wine. And let me just remind you once again, the power of this sacrament. The power is not in the presence of the pastor or the priest. The power is in the presence of Jesus, and he can be with you wherever you are right now. The power is not in the words that I say, but in the promise that Jesus makes to come to you and be with you. So let's now prepare. Well, in my message today, I told you about a woman who lost her husband and only child. But then she literally walked right into Jesus. She kind of just bumped into Jesus. She thought it was an accident. And that encounter changed everything. Jesus stretched out his hand, and just one touch changed everything. You say, yeah, Jeff, but what are the chances I'm going to bump into Jesus today? All right? Well, I'd say pretty good. Pretty darn good. Because Jesus is going to come to you right now through Holy Communion, through his body and blood, through his power and presence. He is going to touch you. Just one touch. It's all it takes for everything dead in you to come alive, for everything dark in you to brighten up, for everything that is impossible and beyond you to become possible. Let's get ready. On the night when he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He broke it and he passed it among his disciples, and he said to them, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this to remember me." And we remember you today, Jesus. We share together the body of Christ. That's his presence right now in your life and in my life. And in that way also, no matter how many miles away we are from each other, we are one at this moment as we are brought together by Christ. And then Jesus took the cup. And after giving thanks to his Father in heaven, he passed it among them. And he said to them, "This is my blood, the blood of the true covenant, which has been poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of all your sins. Do this often in remembrance of me." Today, we remember you, Jesus. We honor you. We love you. And especially today, we thank you that with just one touch, you can change everything in our lives. The presence of Jesus. And as you swallowed that juice, that wine, as you received the blood of Christ, as that washed down, it was like it washed away all your sins once again, and you are entirely and completely forgiven in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now that you have received the body and the blood, the power and the presence of the risen Lord Jesus Christ, may he strengthen you and may he preserve you in the true faith until that magnificent moment when you walk through those gates of glory to see your loved ones waiting for you and to see your God eye to eye and face to face. Amen. Well, you know, someone said to me recently, "Do you know what the theme was of your first sermon of the year 2020? The first Sunday in 2020, your theme was, it's gonna be a great year. And they said, I bet you wish you could take that back right now. Well, to be honest, no, I don't. I mean, 2020 was an unusual year. It was a memorable year. But for most of us, hey, we saw God do a lot of good things in our life. We enjoyed some special closeness with our family. We saw God's special care. We stopped taking a lot of things for granted, things like toilet paper and paper towels. And now, on the first Sunday of this brand new year, I say, it's gonna be a great year. We're gonna have some fun in 21. And so I say with a smile on my face today and with joy in my heart, Jesus, lead on. Lead us into this new year. Here's our band recorded live in worship with Jesus, Lead On.
This is my cry, and this is my song. You are my guiding light when the ways are known, and when these shine.
Well, thank you so much for being with us. You know, we're entering a new year, and I hope we're going to enter it together, and we're going to stay close through this new year. And I invite you to join us again next week as we continue our series on emotions. You know, in 2019, this is very interesting. Try to follow this little stat in your mind. In 2019, 8% of the American population suffered from anxiety disorder. 8%. 1 year later, in 2020, the number had climbed to 36%. Right now, 36% of our population has been diagnosed with anxiety disorder. So next week, we're going to talk about how to find relief from anxiety. And I'll show you how Jesus handled the pressure, how Jesus handled the things that produce anxiety when he was in the Garden of Gethsemane, knowing the cross was coming. Join us next week for that. And our final act of worship today is to bring our gift to God. Go to our website, clcsouthwick.org, and right there on the home page, you'll find a giving tab. And I thank you for your support of our ministry through 2020 and for making us strong as we enter 2021. And now let me send you out today with a blessing. Now may the risen Lord Jesus Christ walk ahead of you into the new year. May he lead you. May he walk behind you to support you. And may he walk beside you as your best and closest friend. Amen. And go now with joy. We will, for we go with God. Thanks, everybody. See you next week.